All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Zell Visiting Writers Series. My name's Ashley, and we're delighted to have you all here. I would ask right now if you could please silence your cell phones. Also, if you are new to our events and would like to get added to our mailing list, there's a survey that you can fill out on your way out. It also asks how you learned about the event. I'm going to turn this over to Chris Crowder in a minute. He's going to introduce Shane McCrae. These events happen roughly every other Thursday throughout the winter semester, and there's flyers outside listing all of the wonderful authors we have visiting us this semester. So I will turn it over to Chris. Either way.
You might want to stand over there, that'll be a troublesome.
Yeah, the glare.
In Shane McCrae's poem, A Thousand Pictures, he writes, "A picture says a picture is only a picture of not what the picture is a picture of, but what it's for. A picture is a picture of the future." Upon reading this for the first time, I stared at it in fascination for several minutes, wrapping my head around the logic. But the time the reader spends with McCrae's wonderfully tumbling imagery and syntax is anything but frustrating. It's rather magical. His words beg to be studied, inviting you to allow a new thought to envelop you, take you over for a while, and then take permanent residence in your conscience long after you finish reading the poem. It's his meter and breaking of parts that require multiple readings of enjoyment and discovery. His work is an open text where the words breathe different actions and takeaways for each reader. Some of McCrae's most prominent themes in his work involve biracial identity, faith, oppression, and segregation that spans across generations in the United States. In a recent sonnet series published in the New Yorker titled Jim Blimber in Heaven, he challenges the glorified imagination of heaven. In this series of poems, heaven is not safe. There isn't a celebration. Heaven isn't full of different looking people. Rather, heaven is occupied by angels who scare people, protecting the idea of it. And this depiction of the guardians of heaven stretches to magnify the racial disparities that have marred America's past and present, an investigation McCrae has embarked on in his writing. Often his work challenges ideas of what's good and who that goodness is for, who that goodness leaves out. His poems help us see historical advantages and privilege and who is suffering for that advantage to remain in place. McCrae's work is an act of breaking free from oppression. His technique and syntax challenge boundaries as he uses his winding words to bring the reader into his thought process. In McCrae's newest collection, The Gilded Auction Block, released in 2019, America, the idea, and the country are addressed in an arresting fashion. But the way in that McCrae does this is what makes him inventive. He invites the reader to seriously, constructively, incessantly think about his words, to let words change them. In the poem, If You See Something, Say Something, he calls out America by telling us that the American dream and a perfect vision of the country only live in certain eyes. This is one of the main points of the Gilded Auction Block, that the imagined American dream of some Americans is a false and often terrifying projection. In the poem Seaware, McCrae expresses this coercion and what it's like to be biracial in a majority white population, writing, "The problem isn't that I don't see faces like mine, it's I don't see inner lives like mine." It's phrases like this that make me feel incredibly known as a biracial person. It's phrases like these where the syntax helps in speaking volumes about the complexity of emotion in occupying spaces. Among other skills, McCrae's poetry is profound because of his ingenious and astute ways to describe personal experience that will speak for people for generations to come, much like a picture does. And in this world, some of the most crucial work makes those who haven't been listened to before feel seen while others listen. Shane McCrae is a poet and educator at Columbia University and is the poetry editor of Image Journal. He's a graduate of Linfield College, earned his MFA from the Iowa Writers' Workshop, and has a JD from Harvard Law School. He's a recipient of a Whiting Award, the Kate Tufts Discovery Award, a Guggenheim Fellowship, a Lannan Literary Award, and many other accolades. He's the author of 6 collections, including In the Language of My Captor, which was a finalist for the National Book Award in 2017. Everyone, please join me in welcoming Shane McCrae.
Awesome. Thank you for that introduction. That was really great. And thank you all for having me. Especially thank you, Ashley, for putting it all together. I had thought that my face would be looming over you the whole time, and I'm sorry that that's gone. Okay, so I'm gonna start with I'm gonna start by reading some new poems. Just, I don't know, because I thought it would be fun, and because most of these I haven't read anywhere. And then I'm going to read poems from my next book, Sometimes I Never Suffered, which comes out in June. The new poems, I have this idea that I'm going to write a book that's like 200 pages long just to see what that's like. That's what these are from. This is called... The Lost Tribe of Eden at the Beginning of the Days of Blood. Each night the trees at the edges of the garden stretched close together, and the slender branches of each tree intertwined with the slender branches of its neighbor, and the leaves of one enfolded the leaves of the other, and the trees together made a wall and partial roof. The people of the tribe of Eden saw the colors of the Milky Way above them if they looked directly up, if they leaned so far back they almost lost their balance, tilting their heads back to the edge of falling. But if they looked ahead and up, the wall blocked what they all imagined were more stars from the moment the first stars appeared each night. At the horizons, God rehearsed the world, struggling especially to get time right, and held the night and colors in the sky above the garden, wheeling days around it like a whirlwind, one, the next, each bloodier than the day before it, endless blood, but fitting in a finite space of time. But how? God first thought time itself was flawed, but time was God's first mirror, as impossible and simple as themselves, almost. It was flawless, almost. No, the flaw from which blood poured endlessly had to be something else, and God reset the days again. And spun them forward and reset and spun them, and for generations of the tribe of Eden, God rehearsed the world. Until one night a boy who hoped to see the sky beyond the edges of the visible climbed one of the trees in the wall of trees, the tree, though it had stretched to stop the tribe from seeing the sky at the horizon, stood still, and it was a tree. A boy was climbing, being a tree, and the boy climbed quickly through the canopy and saw the whirling days and saw faces like his in the days and faces like no faces he had ever seen, and raw, incomprehensible machines and blood. None in the tribe had seen blood before. Even the happiness he saw looked strange to him, shadowed as if with the shadows at the edges of the wall. The stunned boy lost his balance and fell through the canopy to the garden floor and broke his bones, and bones broke through his skin. The boy's blood glistened on the rocks and flowers. This is called, the title is something that I was walking home with my daughter the other day, and I could have sworn this is what she said, but she said this is not what she said. So this poem is called The King of the Sadnesses of Dogs. 1. I brought my gift to the king of the sadnesses of dogs. He sighed the sigh he sighs in the stories children read. The sigh that makes the dogs of the kingdom howl. No matter how far from the king the dogs might rest their noisy heads. I set my gift on the stack at the foot of the 10 steps by which one mounts from the long blue gold-fringed rug to the foot of the throne of the king. I walked the length of the hall beside the rug upon which none but the king walks and set my gift on top of the stack, then bowed and backed away. The throne looked chiseled from a single stone the color of yellowed bone and flecked with brown like meat and blood clinging to bone, the stain and spread of them being yellow. He sighed the sigh he sighs, and close disharmonies filled the grand hall as if an organist had pressed down all the keys of a pipe organ bigger than the hall itself. The stampede of dogs' sadnesses rattled the men in the stained glass in the high windows at which the sunlight stopped, through which it could not pass, sadnesses crowded so against the glass. I tripped and fell and was pinned by the howls, flat on my back, on the glassy stones beside the rug. 2. I saw myself a man-sized beetle writhing on the glassy green and white stones, my arms flapping, my green body twisting, bucking to free itself of the vision by enacting it, trapped by its struggle to get free. I saw myself and saw the gold I weeks before had scooped from the stream beside my shanty in my hand in the small water cupped in my hand, and saw the thin ring I had hammered from the gold, sunken in the glass box I had borrowed from my neighbor, knowing I never would return it. I saw myself writhing on the stones, wearing the nicest suit my neighbor would lend me, and I still saw myself sending it back by courier from the palace in a burlap sack stamped with the king's seal, while the howls shook the stones as if they were an army stamping on the stones, and all around me borrowed men trembled on the stones. So I like to write in form, but I'm not very competent, and about a month ago, I finally managed to write a villanelle, and I managed to do so by ignoring a lot of the rules of a villanelle. I would say before I read this that every George in this poem either is a poet or wrote a lot of poems, even if that's not how we think of them. and this is called The Memoir. George Trackle died of cocaine all my life. The stories I was told replaced my life. My father's father died when I was 8. The stories I was told about my father, he didn't come or came to my birth late. George Byron died of fever all my life. He lived in Oregon, he lived in Brazil, with 2 new children and a dark-skinned wife. My father's father died when I was 8. Too far away to ever visit me. My mother's parents told me not to wait. George Moses Horton died of blank all my life. His family stole and did drugs and was black. His brother with a hammer or a knife murdered my father's father. I was 8. My mother's parents knew you have to kill the child with what you want the child to hate. Her kidneys killed George Eliot all my life. My father's father died when I was 8. I'm already taking up too much of your time. There's so many poems. I've been trying to write a sequence of love sonnets for my wife, whom I coincidentally love, but I have sort of, I don't think, been super successful, though I've written a lot of them, but I did manage to write this sonnet about how bad husbands are. And it's called Husbands. And it has an epigraph from a song by Savages called Husbands. And the epigraph is, "My house, my bed, my husbands. O dream, I live in which I dream, whose dreams I have and failing tried, not harming them to live inside, too often making, like a pet dog suddenly unfamiliar, killing a wild rabbit enraged for no reason he, even with the body between his red teeth, knows. Subsuming the wild blood and body, too often making your dreams mine, and leaves his wildness after, and returns to his old self. But now for anyone who saw him wild, the blood now stains his teeth forever. For anyone who saw the rabbit move still, like it was alive still, moving with the motion of the jaws consuming it. And this is the last poem from the book that I haven't even finished writing that I'm going to read. And it's one of the first ones I wrote for it. And it's called Whom I Have Blocked Out. Asked, have you ever asked, ridden a horse before? Said, he's real gentle and lifted me up. I trusted what men said was gentle to hurt. And I knew I couldn't say no to what men said was gentle and lifted me up. On to the horse, no, saddle he, without a saddle seemed naked. The horse seemed more naked than I could make myself naked, but not as naked as I could be made to be. Lifted me up from the day at the farm into the memory already forming me, bent low, shivering, clinging to the mane alive, but not as part of the body of the horse, alive as part of the wind, the fire at the end of the wind, me burning in it, 6 years old by six, I have already been a sickness in the hearts of men. By six, I've been the sieve through which they expel their sickness. Said, you ever ridden, said the man, who must have been the father of the friend from school who had invited me to the farm. And this is how I have forgiven him. I have remembered only the beginning of the ride. Then nothing, then the bath in the trough in the field, far from the house, in the brown water, stripping in the field. Your body is a gift you have to live through. Remember me, my suffering to me. To whom have I been suffering? To whom will I be healed? So, I do have a book coming out in June, and it is the end of a epic sequence I've been working on, and it's all poems in heaven, and I'm only going to read from one part of those poems. They're spoken by a character, Jim Limber, who lived in a multiverse, and now that he is dead, lives in a multi-heaven. All of them are in a multi-heaven, except for one who is in limbo. So, these are all sonnets, by the way, except for the one in limbo is not a sonnet. This is Jim Limber describes his arrival in heaven. What was it like? It wasn't like the candle. Went out in my bedroom, and next I found myself in the sun outside. I felt myself, my body, more so much I couldn't tell for sure if it was mine. I thought I was chasing a big dog through the tallest grass I'd ever seen, grass taller than the tall grass me and Mama hid from the master in the night before the morning Mrs. Davis took me away. And somehow that dog stayed just an inch or two ahead. I was already dead, and had been dead some time. Then all at once, I saw the grass was giant wings, it was angels' wings, whipping my hands and face. I should have mentioned Jim Limber was a historical person who was kind of informally adopted during the last year of the Civil War by Jefferson Davis, president of the Confederacy. This is Jim Limber on the inability of the enslaved to see themselves. I always thought in heaven I would be an angel. I might be, but I don't think I am. I didn't think I'd still be me. I guess I thought I would be white, a pink face floating over a white sheet. I ain't pictured no body under that white sheet, but that was where my body would have been. I guess I saw my pink hands poking out of the parts of the sheet where my pink arms would go, I guess. I saw me holding my arms out like I was being crucified. Except I wasn't, I was praising somebody and floating in my whiteness like an angel. Will I still be my body if it changes? This is called Jim Limber's Theodicy, and it is important to know that a theodicy is essentially a justification of the ways of God, an explanation for the existence of evil in the world. Jim Limber's Theodicy. What if it heaven was like my mama said it would be, like gardens spread, like blankets spread wide between rivers, gardens full like rivers, with good food, all kinds, fish, but also okra fried hot, and bread and chicken and even candy, all served on dishes like the dishes white folks got. What if it heaven was like what we laughed about over supper sometimes, and we were here together now in heaven and we saw it together? Me and Mama now, in heaven on a picnic between those rivers. What if in heaven we could have white things and not be white? How would we know how good it was if it was good for everyone? This is Jim Limber on the Peace Which Passeth All Understanding. First thing I saw that heartened me in heaven was a dead field, first thing beyond the gates. I might have thought if I had seen when I was still alive a field in such a state, I might have wondered whether it had ever been cultivated, whether Negroes had worked it, and if I had, I might have wondered how many died before it got so bad. How many Negroes did it take for the field to die? The deaths of Negroes being the life and death of the earth. I might have asked the dirt, I might have asked the limp brown grass, but there was nothing human in the field. I had never seen that before, death with no people in it. I said they were all sonnets with the last one, but I lied because this also is not a sonnet. This is Jim Limber on the Gardens of the Face of God. Never was good with women. I mean, I had a few women friends at the factory, but that was work. And sometimes I think they were nice to me because they had to be nice to the men, even the men beneath them. And I retired where I started, down. But nobody has to be nice in heaven. Nobody has to smile. God is a woman for some folks in heaven, and God is a man for others, and for some folks, God is both and neither one. For some folks, God is neither one and nothing in between. I see folks, gods, whenever I see their faces, but God don't look like anybody here. For me, God is a woman, and her face is black as a bright black stone. I've walked with her on the path between the apple orchard and the garden in spring when the orchard is a garden. This is Jim Limber on continuity in heaven. And it starts with an image from an earlier poem where Jim Limber talks about there's a train that goes around in a circle around heaven. That poem has more to it, but that's all you need to know. I ride the train for nothing sometimes, just because I can, because I couldn't once. But I don't know if I'm supposed to count that, if this life is more of what life was or something new. I never suffered on the train I ride, but I ain't suffered at the hands of every white man I met, and I still understood who was white and who was something white and altogether black at the same time. It wasn't nothing in the man or me, but something in the life we shared. But I mean share like prisoners share loneliness. I ride the train now like I never suffered on a train. Sometimes I never suffered in my life. Traditionally, poets announce when they have two left. I have four left because I'm a unique individual. So I am announcing it at a different point. This is Jim Limber tells what he knows about heaven. Heaven's a horse, a train, a ship with no captain, or with a captain, but the captain is a Negro, or a rowboat tied but loosely to the dock, the river peaceful, nobody or everybody is a Negro. It's 100 Negroes on the dock, 1,000 Negroes, like when Jesus broke the bread to feed 10,000 people, maybe 15, and the bread just grew and grew. The dock just grows and grows beneath them. 10,000 Negroes cheering you to freedom. 100,000, and you got good shoes and walk to the rowboat smiling and untie it. But heaven ain't you running, but you staying. This is Jim Limber in heaven, writes his name in water. You walk through heaven anywhere to anywhere on that soft green grass, or nowhere, it don't matter, anywhere you walk, a bright and cool, and it's about a foot wide stream of the cleanest water anywhere, with each step you take parts the grass beside you, on your left side if you're left-handed, and on your right side otherwise. Just reach down if you're thirsty or you're dirty or you're hot. They got the sun in heaven still, and folks get hot sometimes. Me, sometimes I walk just to see the stream appear. Sometimes I lead it through my name. On earth, I couldn't spell my name. Now my great thirst has been revealed to me. So as I said, Jim Limber's in a multiverse, and this poem used to be like at the end of the book, and it occurred to me, like 2 months ago, oh, I should put it at the beginning, because then people might have a chance of knowing what I'm talking about. So, this is Jim Limber in Heaven is a nexus at which the many heavens of the multiverse converge. I said I had four left, I had five left, sorry. I've been a long time dead without my life. And when it comes back to me in parts, and sometimes I get two or three, or I don't know how many, 15, 40 of the same part, like I lived the same life 60 different ways. I'll see my face and it's my same face, and I'll be standing where I remember standing once. And if other folks were there, they're there, or some of them, or all of them but me, and some or all of them are wearing different outfits, like the weather in us changed. I think now more than half of life is death, but I can't die enough for all the life I see. And this is, like, technically the last sonnet of the whole Jim Limber sequence, and so the second-to-last poem of the epic. This is Jim Limber on Possibility. And for all of you who mentioned today that there's a little bit of Dante in the poem, you will see it here. What if I had been born in heaven? Do they do that here? I've never seen a baby, but I see full-grown people who I hear the angels whispering. They say they were babies when they died. I always look those people in the eye, but I don't think they see me. And I've never heard them speak. They just walk around in sailor hats with blank looks on their faces. Those white hats with the blue anchors. I sometimes see them walking with their mouths open. The first one I saw like that. And when I tried to talk to him, it was like I wasn't there. So I peeked in his mouth. And in his mouth was the whole sky and stars. And this is the last one, not in the book, just the last one I read because it's my favorite. And it is the one where he is in limbo. And it's called Jim Limber Burning Where No Fire Is. And thank you all for coming out. Such as I've been, I am, I never was bad or a good boy. Except as I was born bad, like, you know, the badness in a glass of fresh milk, if you leave it in the sun, will be exposed by the blazing inquiry. Bad like the sun won't make it fresher, not bad like a white boy's badness lights the sky with a strange second sun that dies unnaturally from the sky. that while it shines down on him, makes the ground he walks a stage, and when it dies, he is himself again. A living Negro never walked a stage. We are the ghosts of who comes after us. In their memorial, I bet I was sent to limbo, because whoever watches wasn't sure what good and bad things I had done, but saw the good and bad things millions of Negroes had done before me on my back and couldn't add the figures up, and thought limbo was good enough and not to darken heaven, darker than heaven has to be. Or it might be a storm of Negroes in heaven. I bet whoever watches sees a storm of Negroes piled high, thrashing on my back. Whoever watches sees a pile of Negroes thinks they're thrashing, because it's so many in one place, but the thrashing's all the rush of the eye from one black body to the next, and it's no thrashing in the bodies, but the wrong is in the eye. I bet whoever watches didn't see I had a storm of Negroes on my back, but it was a black cloud like the black clouds I've seen in the far heaven I've seen from limbo, like the clouds I've seen from which I've seen stars born, such storms as are the glory of the dark. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Shane. That concludes our event. Literati is selling books upstairs. If you have questions for Shane, you're welcome to ask them at the book signing table. Thanks so much for coming.